Ben is editor emeritus of DailyWire.com, host of The Ben Shapiro Show, the top conservative podcast in the nation, and syndicated radio show heard on more than 150 stations nationwide, including 8 of the top 10 markets, and a leading conservative speaker on college campuses, consistently defending free speech and open debate. Shapiro is the author of several different books, including the number one New York Times bestseller, The Right Side of History, How Reason and Moral Purpose Made the West Great, and has recently released The Authoritarian Moment, How the Left Weaponized America's Institutions Against Dissent. Shapiro is also nationally syndicated columnist since age 17 and a graduate of UCLA and Harvard Law School. The New York Times calls him the cool kids philosopher. Rush Limbaugh said Shapiro isn't just content to have people be dazzled by his brilliance. He actually goes out and confronts and tries to persuade, mobilize, and motivate people. Thank you to Fred and Linda Allen for their generous support of this lecture and Ben Shapiro's campus lectures across the country. Please help me in welcoming Ben Shapiro.
Thank you. Hey, how are y'all? This is cool. Good to see everybody. So, well, thank you. That's very nice of you. Well, it's good to see you all in person. Love you too. But don't tell my wife. So, it's great to see everybody in person, obviously, and it is wonderful to be doing events again. This is the first time in over a year that I've spoken to college students or a mass crowd of any kind other than the group of Republican Congress people I spoke to in Orlando maybe 6 weeks ago, where I told them that if they somehow failed to win back the Congress in 2022, each and every one of them should be fired. I want to thank Zoe for the beautiful introduction. Thank Young America's Foundation, as always. Thank Fred and Linda Allen for sponsoring so many of my lectures. All right, so I want to leave a lot of time for Q&A, because frankly, I haven't had a chance to talk with nearly anyone for a year and a half except my small children, and I'm beginning to lose my mind. It's there are only so many conversations you can have about the Octonauts before you begin to wonder if you've lost it. So I'm going to talk a little bit tonight about the battle that you guys face on college campuses, because I think it used to be that in the conservative movement, there was this lie that we told ourselves, particularly those of us who had graduated from college, that, you know, all the crap that we saw on college campuses, all these students, the ones who are woke, the ones who are irritating, the ones who are destroying the body politic, that when they got out in the real world would change them, right? They'd get jobs, they would stop being such annoying losers, they'd have to pay taxes, their pot-smoking habits would eventually have to taper off. You know, all of these things we told ourselves. And instead, it turns out that those college students went out and they took over all of the institutions and they destroyed all of the institutions. And so the stuff happening on the campuses that you attend doesn't stay on the college campuses. It starts there and then it metastasizes out and destroys pretty much every institution in American life. And everyday Americans are now feeling this. By poll statistics, every single political subgroup in the United States, with the exception of people on the radical left, feels as though they can't say what they want to say about politics. That includes people who say that they are mainstream liberals. People who are sort of your typical Democrat voter, they feel that they can't speak freely about politics. And that is because their compatriots on the left know that they can cudgel and bully them into saying whatever they want. Now, all this, again, started on college campuses, and it continues to spring from college campuses, which is why it's so important that you all, you're on the front lines, you really have to fight back, you have to mobilize, you have to organize, and you have to be smart about it. So let's talk about how all this has happened on college campuses and within the institutions more generally. So there are three steps to taking over an institution. And we need to know how the left did it, because we now need to do this in reverse. So the three steps to taking over an institution: number one, you have to win the emotional argument. Number two, you have to renormalize the institution itself, take over the sort of levers of power. And three, you have to close all the doors. So the way that the left typically has done this, they've won the emotional argument with another sort of three-step process. And you see this in the way that people argue on campus all the time. The first step is they take advantage of what I've called the cordiality principle. Why can't you just be nice? Right? Why aren't y'all just nicer? Every time you're in a political conversation with somebody who is of the left, you might bring up a fact, an inconvenient fact, a fact that bothers someone. And someone will say, well, you know, I'm insulted, it just isn't nice. Or maybe, you know, could you lower your voice? It just isn't nice. Just be a little more cordial. And conservatives, because many of us are religious, most of us have respect for other people, in fact, most Americans do, we tend to say, okay, you know what, you're right. We'll be cordial. Let's just not talk about politics. You know, better if we avoid this topic. We'll just come back to it later. Or maybe we won't come back to it at all. We'll just be cordial. Kind of, you know, not take it down from like a 10 to a 0, but we'll take it down from like a 10 to a 4. And then we can have a nice positive conversation without getting into the weeds of anything that might be remotely insulting. And we'll concede terminology in arguments. The most obvious, for example, being the entire argument that is now had over transgender pronouns, right? The left's case is you need to use the pronouns that somebody else chooses because otherwise you're just not being nice. It's not about fact or about being right or about being wrong. It's about being nice, right? The cordiality principle, be cordial. And again, conservatives are uniquely susceptible to this because in our lives, we tend to try and be cordial with other people. Many of us feel a religious obligation to be cordial with other people. So that's step one. The second step is sort of an extension of that. It's sort of a deepening of that principle, and that is speech is violence. I get this a lot on campus. This is where microaggression terminology comes in. And this is the idea that if you say about a man that he is a man, and he in fact wishes to be called a woman, this means that you have not just said something that is non-cordial, you've done an act of violence. You've put them at actual physical risk. You see this on campus all the time. The very language of microaggressions suggests this. Right? A microaggression isn't just something you said that was rude, it's an aggression. Microaggressions are to be met with macroaggressions. There was literally a professor at Cal State University, LA, this is one of my first big YAF speeches, who posted this outside of his office hours. He posted a sign on his door saying, microaggressions should be met with macroaggressions. The idea being, of course, that you have done some sort of violence. And if speech is violence, then sort of by necessity, violence is also speech, right? If the equal sign goes both ways, then if you say something that is violent, it's okay if the violent comes right back at you. When I spoke at Berkeley, there were literally protesters, thousands of them outside, literally chanting, speech is violence. Which, by the way, is a terrible chant. It doesn't rhyme, nothing. But this has become sort of a rote point of contention on the left, that if you say something that offends somebody, you haven't just offended them, you've actually done them violence. That brings us to the third step. And this is one I honestly didn't see coming, because it's so nonsensical and backward. It's so ridiculous on its face that it makes no sense. And yet, we live in a society where nothing makes any sense anymore, so I guess it was inevitable. And that is the move from speech is violence to silence is violence. Now again, better chant, because this one rhymes, but even less sensical than speech is violence. And this is the idea, of course, that if you don't repeat exactly what people on the left want you to say in precisely the words they want you to say, then you have done an act of violence. Right? So we went all the way from, please be nicer in how you broach this issue, to if you say something that offends me, you've done violence to me, to I need you to just say what I am saying and repeat it over and over and over again. And if you refuse to do that, now you've done an act of violence. This is what you see online, for example, when Black Lives Matter is pushing its protests, and many of those are resulting in riots. If you don't actually put a black square on your Facebook page, silence is violence. You are complicit, right? Your complicity is the problem. If only you weren't complicit, if only you just did the malice struggle session and repented all your sins and then said over and over and over the mantra that we want you to say, then all of your sins would be temporarily lifted until the next time we want you to repeat a new mantra, in which case all of your sins are restored until you say the new mantra over and over and over. And this particular tactic has been extremely successful for the left, right? Moving all the way from cordiality principle all the way to silence is violence. Just repeat what we say and we'll leave you alone. And this is part and parcel of the second step, right, which is renormalizing institutions. So renormalization is a term that's used by the sociologist and thinker Nassim Nicholas Taleb. Right? He talks in his book Skin in the Game about this. Renormalization is where a small group of intransigent and extremely loud and annoying people can take over an entire institution. So think of a family of four. This is the example he uses. Think of a family of four, and one of the members of the family, usually the daughter, says she's a vegan. And she goes to mom, and she says, listen, here's the deal. I'm a vegan now. You can make two meals, right? One for the other three members of the family and one for me, or you can make one vegan meal for everyone. And mom, because she doesn't really have time, she says, you know what? It's not worth the hassle. Forget it. I'm just going to make a vegan meal for everyone. Okay, so now the entire family is eating vegan because one girl decided that she definitely needed to eat vegan and she was not going to skimp on this. Okay, then you take that family and they have a block party that week with three other families, and now the family says, listen, because of our daughter, we're eating vegan. That's just what we're doing now. And you, the head of the block party, can either make vegan for everybody, just do, you know, chips and dip and salsa and all that, or you can make meat for everybody and vegan for us. And now the person who's the head of the block party has to decide, do I make two meals or do I make one meal? And so now you can have one person who's renormalized 12, 15, 20 people. Now, typically speaking, it doesn't work with one person. Typically speaking, the tipping point number is somewhere between 15 and 20%, apparently, according to a variety of studies. So if you get 20% of an institution, 20% of any group, to say that they are fixed on a point and they're not moving from the point, then you can get a bunch of other people who are in the middle to kind of go along just to get along. Because honestly, most people are conflict averse. People don't like conflict. The left counts on this. People don't, they're not interested in fighting. They're more interested in having a nice day than they are in fighting with you. And if you're incremental in your approach, then you can get away with all of this. And this is what the left has done so successfully. They start off at a corporation. They say something, 20% of the people will say, listen, all we're asking for, there are a bunch of diverse people here, all we're asking for is a little diversity and sensitivity training so that everybody here can be better educated on people who they are not. And everybody in the middle goes, well, sounds like kind of a pain in the ass, but honestly, like, these people are so whiny and they're just gonna call HR and we might get liability issues and legal is telling us that it would be a better idea to protect ourselves by having a diversity training session. And so the company says, okay, diversity training. And then the next step is, okay, you know what, the diversity training, here's the thing, it's a little bit tepid. We need a little bit more. We need to understand that the institutions of our society are replete with white privilege. And that means it's not enough to have like typical diversity training where we learn to be nice to each other cross-culturally. We have to recognize our own privilege. And this requires us to bring in Robin DiAngelo or Ibram X. Kendi to talk about the inherent privilege of whiteness and how institutions are filled with this whiteness. And everybody in the middle goes, well, you know, this is more of a pain in the ass than the other thing was, but at the same time, they're also threatening us more. Like, they're saying they're gonna go on Twitter and Facebook and call us racist. They're saying they're gonna go to the New York Times and run a whole story about how our company is steeped in white privilege. I guess we'll just do it. And you can see how this happens in every institution, right? They start with just these kind of minor requests, and the minor requests become more and more major over time. Now, I will say I think that the left right now is moving too far too fast. I think it's why you're seeing blowback, for example, in the public schools with critical race theory. Because I think that the sort of turning up the temperature on the frog, if you turn it up too fast, the frog jumps out. I think they've turned up the temperature a little too fast and the blowback is going to be immense. But for 50 years, they've been turning it up pretty slowly and they've been able to get away with an enormous amount of change and take over the highest point in our institutional life because of it. Put together these coalitions of the woke and intransigent. By the way, to get to that 20%, you don't actually require the full 20% to agree with everything you're saying. All you have to do is create a coalition that gets you to 20%. This is why on your campuses, what you will see is a bunch of student groups who apparently have nothing in common, all banding together in order to do X. Right, so if they want to ban a speaker from campus, something with which I have some familiarity, if they want to do this, what they will do is they will go get the LGBT group on campus, and they will side with the BLM group on campus, and they will side with the Muslim Student Association on campus. And those of us on the right, we look at this and we're like, hold up a second. You're telling me that the Muslim Student Association, the LGBTQ group, they're on the same side of this, right? What, they have nothing in common, right? This makes no sense at all. But you have to understand that it is a coalition deal, right? They are trading away some of their priorities for the moment in order to achieve their higher priority, which is to renormalize the institution and achieve a set goal. Now, politically speaking in the United States, I think this is largely what has happened in our politics since about 2012. I think there's a historic shift in American politics. You guys are all really young, so this seems really long ago to you guys. But as you will see, as you get older, time starts to telescope. So for Governor Walker and for me, this is like 5 minutes ago. So the election of 2012, which was not all that long, it's now 9 years ago, guys, crazy. But the election of 2012 totally changed the country. For my money, a lot of people always say the most important election of our lifetimes is whatever the next election is. And typically that's not very true. The 2012 election really was an important election for the following reason. In 2008, Barack Obama was still operating within the auspices of traditional American politics. Right? He ran as no blue states, no red states, United States. No blacks, no whites, just Americans. Right? This was the idea. We were all one. This is a very e pluribus unum. Right? In God we try. He was running on motherhood and apple pie and the American flag. He really was in 2008. And then he came into office and he started proposing a very radical agenda. And the radical agenda, as it turned out, was really unpopular. And it spurred the Tea Party, which was a bunch of people who went out in the streets and they said, we shouldn't be spending this kind of money. This is crazy. You won a victory not on the basis of this. It sounds kind of familiar with what's going on now, actually. You didn't win a victory for this. You won a victory in order to, you know, bring Americans together, and here you are proposing radical policy that tears us apart. Barack Obama loses Congress in 2010. In his own words, he takes a shellacking, right? And then his response is, everyone who opposes me is racist, right? The Tea Party is racist. And if you read his memoirs, he says this pretty openly. Like, he and Michelle would sit around watching TV and pointing at the Tea Party and saying, these folks are racist. And between 2010 and 2012, he decided he was going to move on to a different strategy. He's, I believe, the only president in American history who won fewer votes his second time than his first time around and still won re-election, right? He won 3 million fewer votes in 2012 than in 2008. He won by such a big margin in 2008, he could afford to do that and still win. But what he did is he decided to pursue a dream that Democrats have been pursuing ever since. And that dream was, what if I did renormalization on a grand scale in American politics? I will find a bunch of groups, I will appeal to them as identity groups. We will form a coalition. This coalition will be designated at taking down the hierarchies of power in the United States. And I'm not going to try to win every vote. I'm not going to try and make my message broad and appealing to a huge majority of Americans. Instead, I'm going to tailor my message to every specific group, cobble together just enough people to create a new coalition of the ascendant, and we will never lose an election again. The reason you have to understand this is because this is why people lost their minds on the left side of the aisle when Trump won. It wasn't just because it was Trump. It's because Democrats did not think they would ever lose another election after 2012. You can read the way they were writing in 2013. They thought they had created a new model in American politics. And this model was the renormalization model. Right? Get together all these coalitions, they will be the new majority, and everybody else doesn't matter anymore. And then Trump came along and he took the people who they'd left out of their coalition and he made them into their own coalition, and then he won in 2016. And now, President Biden is trying to rebuild the Obama coalition, and he's trying to do the same thing. This is why he's talking about equity all the time, for example. It's why he's taken a very left-wing position on racial issues. It's why he's decided that he's not going to govern as the so-called Biden won for two reasons. One, he's dead, and two, he was perceived as moderate. Right? He's been able to keep only one of those promises. Okay, that renormalization of American politics has had dramatic implications for all of our institutions, which have mirrored the same exact move over the course of time. Corporate America is now oriented against conservatives because woke people inside these corporations have taken over at least the levers of power inside a lot of these corporations. Not because they actually run the corporations, but because they know they can leverage the people at the heads of the corporations into doing what they want by heading on over to the New York Times and having the New York Times write a hit piece on the heads of the corporation. You see this in science, right? The scientific institutions, the place you thought was going to be untouchable, right? I did. I thought science is a process, right? How do you screw with the process? Somehow they've managed to take scientific institutions and renormalize the institutions to the point where they are now repeating woke mantras as part of science. We saw this last year when you had people out in the streets protesting lockdown. That was totally going to spread COVID and kill everyone. But if you were out there spitting on each other for George Floyd, COVID didn't care. It was the wokest virus in all of human history. If you had the proper political principles, you were totally fine. And not only that, you were going to be told that racism was a public health problem akin to COVID, so it was totally fine for you to go out in the streets and do whatever you wanted to do. And you saw this again from the CDC in their original proposal for trotting out vaccines, which was not on the basis of age, which was clearly the scientific way to trot out vaccines. Instead, they said we should tranche out vaccines on the basis of racial equity, which is madness. I mean, utter craziness, which statistically, by the way, would have ended with more dead black people than if they'd tranched out on the basis of age. Because if you immunize a bunch of 20-year-old black people and you skip a bunch of 65-year-old black people, even if proportionally speaking, the 65-year-old black people are less of a percentage of the total population than 20-year-old black people are, this would have ended with more dead elderly black people, right? This is clear as day in the science. Didn't matter. The CDC was promoting it anyway. You've seen scientific institutions renormalized. You've seen the media obviously renormalized. The media is just a weapon of the Democratic Party at this point. There's no question about this. The propaganda that they have subjected the American people to, particularly since 2016, is absolutely astounding. And then finally, the social media companies and basically fallen prey to all of this as well. Not only are they headed by people who are sort of congenitally liberal, as Zuckerberg has admitted, right, Silicon Valley is a left-wing place. Not only that, they've now been leveraged by the media and by the Democratic Party into basically suppressing freedom of speech and First Amendment freedoms on behalf of the government. They're private companies, but once they become government agents, they cease to be in the private sphere only. Okay, so what does this mean for you guys? What it means is we need to take some lessons from the left. Okay, what that means is we should not be quite as cordial as the left would wish us to be, because they are not telling you the truth when they say they want you to be cordial. This doesn't mean be rude. It doesn't mean get up in people's faces, Maxine Waters style. It doesn't mean be a jerk. It does mean that if you are saying something true, you should not be so worried about who it offends. If you're saying a true thing that is backed by data and somebody gets offended, that would be a them problem. And you should, it is not incumbent on you to treat a fact as a matter of un-niceness, as a matter of meanness. You can't be cordial in these arguments. Frankly, honestly, this is one of the reasons that Trump existed, right? Is because Trump completely ditched cordiality to like the ultimate extreme. And that was his charm, it was also his drawback, but there's a way for you to do it in a way that is very effective, because it is not your job to worry about whether somebody's feelings are hurt. It is your job to worry about whether somebody's feelings are being unjustifiably hurt. Second point, if we're going to re-normalize these institutions, right, if we're going to normalize them back to what they were, what that means on college campuses is that you're going to have to build coalitions. You're going to actually have to do some Barack Obama-style community organizing. You're going to have to actually go out there and form a hardcore of intransigent people on your campus who can create a solid front against whatever the left is doing. Okay, it's not enough for one or two people to speak out. It's not even enough for there to be just a YAF group on campus. You have to form coalitions with other groups, and then you should be intransigent, and you should be loud, and you should be aggressive, and you should push back. Because the people in the middle are going to either react by siding with you, or more likely, they're going to react by throwing their hands up and saying, I don't want any part of this. And guess what? If people in the middle say, we don't want a pox on both your houses, right? We don't want any part of this, we all win. That is a victory. Okay, we don't have to turn all of these institutions right wing. We have to turn these institutions neutral again. Okay, now that's much harder on college campuses because, unfortunately, the renormalization on college campuses happened from above. It's not just coming from the student body, it's coming from the faculty. It's coming from the professors, it's coming from the administrators, and all the rest. But what that means is that you should do what the left has so successfully done at institutions they don't control, which is use the media. And I've said to everybody, my mentor Andrew Breitbart used to say this, and so I'll pass it on to you. You have a cell phone, the cell phone has a camera upon it, you are now reporters. You have all been deputized, congratulations. Right? If you see something on campus that is newsworthy, send it to us at Daily Wire, we will 100% write it up, we'll get it out for you, and it will become a news story. People care these days what happens on college campuses, and we can turn those things into stories. It's good for us financially, it's good in terms of traffic, but much more importantly, it's better for the country if attention is brought to what's happening on campus. So you should for sure be doing that. And then finally, be strategic. Right? The left is strategic. They don't go all out all at once. Right? It requires a little bit of incrementalism. So that means don't lead with your chin. Right? Pick your spots. Pick points where you think that the left has clearly gone too far, and fight there and push back, because that's how you create winning coalitions. That's how you get people in the middle to side with you. You don't pick the outlying issue where you know you're in the minority. Instead, what you do is you pick the issue where the left steps too far. And good news for you, the left is doing this every single day. They're annoying, they're incoherent, they bother everyone. Right? On your campuses, most people don't care about politics. I mean, let's be frank about this. On college campuses, most people want to shtup, drink, and basically get whatever grade they need to go to grad school. Okay, that's what college campuses are for. What that means is that most of the people on campus are not politically motivated. Most of the people on campus want to be left alone. The left doesn't leave them alone, right? That's why they cave to them. So if you go to them and they say, listen, you can side with us, we'll leave you alone, that's a pretty good pitch. It also happens to comport pretty well with a sort of conservative philosophy, which is that you are now adults and you should be treated like adults. And by the way, the conservatism also has, believe it or not, a much more compassionate side than liberalism, which is a woke religion without forgiveness. Right? The left is a woke religion without forgiveness. All they are interested in is digging up your old Twitter posts. All they are interested in doing is finding your bad old Facebook posts and then destroying you or holding it over your head blackmail style until you repeat what they want, silence is violence. Right? We on the right don't do that. We on the right are not going to hold things over your head. If you run with us, you're going to lead a much happier life than if you run with the radical left. I've said before that I think the future of the country does not lie with the right and it does not lie with the left. It depends on what the people in the middle do. Those people in the middle can be convinced. So that requires you to be strategic, and it requires you to be outgoing and warm. And most of all, it requires you to be aggressive enough to confront the left without being so aggressive that you're off-putting to people in the middle. And I think all of you are capable of doing that. I think conferences like this arm you with the facts and with the strategies to do that. That's why I'm so happy to be here. And now I want to take your questions, because I haven't talked to a human being above the age of 7 for like a year. Yeah, you can go ahead.
Is it on? Hi, I'm Hannah. I just graduated from Hunter College. Somehow more conservative than I walked in. Don't even ask how that's possible. I just want to know your opinion on this. Do you think that the recent advent of a virtual and online school has actually pushed the left into a sort of corner? Because I used to come home and tell my mother what I was learning, and she said, you have to be exaggerating, and I said, no, I'm really not. And then I ended up homeschooled online college, and then she finally heard. So you think that the homeschooling, instead of being the socially isolating nightmare, which it sort of was actually a huge blessing?
Well, I certainly agree there's been a lot more transparency in the educational system because parents are finally seeing what's been going on in the schools, right? I mean, you didn't see it at all. And now because of Zoom school, a lot of parents are finally seeing what's going on in the classroom. There is sort of a weird conservative self-contradiction in the sense that we're not huge fans of public school, but we're like, everybody go back to public school. I mean, the reality is that what we really should be pushing is for more and more people to get the hell out of public school and go to parochial school and charter schools and private schools and home schools, because, you know, until we take back the public schools themselves, it's going to be a problem. But yes, I agree with you. There's been some blessings in disguise there for sure.
Okay, Mr. Shapiro, in your debunked episode on gun control, you said that the federal constitution was never meant to apply to the states and that states have the right to regulate firearms. According to this logic, the states have the right to censor your speech, put National Guard soldiers in your house, and force you to self-incriminate.
I mean, that's technically true. I mean, that is. I mean, the reality is that the constitution as originally constructed was designed to apply to the federal government, which is why all of the amendments say Congress shall affect no law, right? I mean, it's all about Congress. Now, that's not how the Supreme Court has interpreted it, right? This is called incorporation, right? So the Supreme Court has engaged in what they say. It's actually kind of a made-up legal fiction, but it's effective for these purposes. They said that via the 14th Amendment equal protection and due process clauses, all of the First Amendments were now incorporated to the states. Right? This is what they say, this Supreme Court doctrine. The point that I was making in the debunked episode is that for a long time, what the left was arguing is that the Second Amendment did not apply via the Incorporation Clause. It was the only amendment they were arguing did not apply via the Incorporation Clause. So I was actually making your point, which is, if you are going to argue that the Second Amendment does not apply to the states, then neither does the First Amendment or the Third Amendment or the Fourth Amendment. But yes, technically speaking, I mean, the federal constitution applies to the federal government. That's what the federal government, I mean, it's the federal constitution. So there's what it was originally meant to do, then there's how it's been constructed legally speaking by the Supreme Court. And the point that I was making is that the Second Amendment should be constructed in a similar way if you're gonna say the First Amendment applies to the states via the incorporation clause of the 14th, you have to say the same thing about the Second Amendment.
Okay, thank you.
Good evening, my name is Mike. I'm from Columbus State, Columbus, Ohio. Going off of the title of your book, Facts Don't Care About Your Feelings, since liberals tend to function primarily off of emotion, how is it possible for conservatives to speak logically and reasonably to such an illogical and unreasonable audience?
So I think that it depends on who you are talking to and under what context you're talking to them. I agree with you. If somebody is operating solely on the basis of emotion, then feelings also don't care about your facts, right? And that's a serious problem when you're talking with some folks who are on the left. Those conversations are just ones in which you shouldn't engage. I've said this over and over and over. I mean, I think this is true about virtually all conversations in human life, which sometimes makes me antisocial. But I think that you should really evaluate whether a conversation is worth it and what the goal of the conversation is. When it comes to emotional conversations about feelings, I tend to restrict those to immediate family. When it comes to conversations about feelings with randos who want to tell me why politics should revolve around their feelings, I tend to avoid those conversations in the first place. But I will say that the presupposition of any political conversation is going to be that we have to speak the same language. You can't speak the subjective language of emotions unless those emotions are rooted in some sort of objective, verifiable fact that we can all discuss together. Otherwise, the conversation is completely pointless. You're atomistic individuals who exist in your own bubbles.
Good evening, Dr. Shapiro. Nice to meet you.
Oh, I'm not a doctor. Well, neither is Joe Biden.
I was a juris doctor. I consider that a doctor. With that said, my name is Marcus Seche, and I'm a student at Loyola University Chicago. And by the way, it's quite nice to enjoy electricity and air conditioning because we can't do that in a socialist country. With that said, I just have a question because when it comes to a conservative conversation, this has come up with, and sometimes, you know, it has made me think a couple of times. When it comes to Israel, and a lot of one of the criticisms that I have received about the defense of Israel is how does it benefit the Republican Party and America, especially sometimes when it comes to like Israel social progress socially has a lot of very progressive ideas, especially in abortion. The abortion law there is very flexible. So how does it benefit the United States and the Republican Party? It's kind of like what I've heard about. So I wanted to see what was your take on it.
So, I mean, when it comes to Israel's domestic policies with regard to social policy, I think they're terrible and I think they should change. We support a wide variety of countries that have social policies far to the left of the United States. And if we could impact that, I wish we would. I mean, I think that an abortion in Israel is just as tragic and evil as an abortion in the United States. Abortion is an evil. It remains evil no matter where you're doing it. Anything else would be bizarre. As far as the interests of the United States and the Republican Party in maintaining an alliance with the state of Israel, Israel has been described by members of the military as sort of an American aircraft carrier in the Middle East. It is the only solid ally that the United States has. Israel, the foreign aid that is used for Israel typically develops technology, which is then also handed over to the United States, or Israel uses that money in order to essentially subsidize the defense industry in the United States. I've always found it bizarre that people who are very upset with it, I understand the argument, by the way, that we shouldn't have foreign aid, period. I do. I get that argument. That's an argument that at least has a consistency to it. What I've always had a problem with is when people are like, well, foreign aid to Israel is the real problem. It's like, well, are you aware of where else we give foreign aid in the world? Like, there are a lot of worse places to give foreign aid than to a democratic state that actually has our back in war, in peace, and in democracy. And so I think that it's sort of important to go to what exactly are people arguing over. But, I mean, I'm not aware that foreign aid to Israel is being used for abortion. If it were, I would be in favor of cutting it off, unlike apparently the president, who's in favor of getting rid of the Hyde Amendment. So.
Thank you.
Hi. My name is Grace, and I'm a graduate student at Minnesota State University.
Ooh, good times.
Yep. my question is sort of two parts, and the first is, do you believe that we should strive for colorblindness, as in removing race as the social construct that it is, seeing, you know, content of character, MLK values? And if so, how would you go about guiding or convincing someone on the left or the right to overcome assumptions, knee-jerk assumptions about race, especially when they refuse to watch films like Uncle Tom?
Yeah, I mean, I think that obviously that is what we should be striving for, because forget about race. You should treat people as individuals regardless of their status. I mean, I think that's true with regard to age. I think it's true with regard to religion. Like, treating people as members of groups primarily ignores their humanity. If you want to see the fulsomeness of somebody's humanity, yes, group membership can make a difference to them, but that's up to them, right? You don't get to judge somebody simply by dint of whatever group they are in, and that's an act of stereotyping and indeed often racism. Honestly, the way to convince people about this, it really depends on who you're talking to. I keep saying this, but it really does matter. You do have to tailor your conversations depending on the response of the person you're talking to. When people take a racially essential view, which is that membership in a particular race, your immutable characteristic just makes you X, you have to ask them why that is. Like, why? What is the connection? What does level of melanin in your skin have to say about your politics? Like, there are arguments to be made that groups that have been victimized in American history have common interests with regard to, for example, relieving that victimization, when that victimization is ongoing, for example. Right? For example, just to take a historical example, it's 1963, segregation is ongoing in the South. Black Americans have a collective interest in getting rid of segregation in the South. And it would be hard to say that there's a lot of good reasons why a black American would be in favor of maintaining segregation in the South. But when we are talking about neutral institutions and best policies of neutral institutions in a land where discrimination has been legally forbidden by the federal government and state and local governments for the last nearly 60 years, then you have to start asking, where exactly is the collective interest, and why do you insist that immutable characteristics define the collective interest as opposed to the arguments that you're making?
Thank you.
Howdy, Mr. Shapiro. My name is Jose, and I come from Lone Star Community College. And I proudly come from Venezuela. However, I dream with the day that I will proudly be an American citizen. And however, However, but my question to you will be, how would you deal with all these people that will call you a sellout or a white wannabe just because you're proud of the country that gave you a second chance in life?
I mean, anybody who says that, number one, is a fool, and you should be able to say straight to them that they're a fool. I mean, the fact is that if you come from... First of all, I've noticed that a lot of the people who like to call people sellouts are people who have never actually experienced tyranny. It seems to be a common trait. You know, people in the United States who've never lived under Venezuelan tyranny or Cuban tyranny are very happy to call people sellouts and traitors for belonging to parties they don't belong to when they've never had to, you know, experience that firsthand. And they can dream of socialist utopia without actually having to live in one because it doesn't exist. If people call you that, again, I do not think that insults have to be met with rational discourse. If somebody calls you a sellout, I think you are perfectly justified in calling them an asshole. I really do. You can't argue somebody out of an insult. You really can't. And you have to establish that if you have like an honest conversation, we can have an honest conversation, but it's going to have to start with you not insulting me or my character.
Amen. Thank you. Shapiro 2024.
Hey, Ben. My name is Samantha. I'm going to be attending Rice University next year. So as you know, a lot of college students are dealing with the vaccine and a lot of things that are going along with it. And my college specifically, they're saying that you don't have to get the vaccine, but if you don't get the vaccine, you have to wear a mask and you have to get tested quite frequently. And I was just wondering how you would go about combating that or what your opinion on a more broadly two-tiered society on vaccines would be, because I know you've mentioned this on your show, where people who have the vaccine can go about life and do what they want, while people who do not have the vaccine and who do not use that choice are stuck.
Right, so two things. One, private companies have the right to do, and private corporations have the right to do what they want in this particular space, just as a private corporation. A private baker can say, I don't feel like baking the cake for a gay wedding. A private baker can also say, I don't feel like dealing with people who are unvaccinated. Do I think that's good policy? No. I think it's bad policy for a variety of reasons, including the fact that if you separate the vaccinated from the unvaccinated, what you're likely to have is a higher level of infection. Right. If you the whole point of having vaccinated people mixing with unvaccinated people is vaccinated people are far less likely to pass along the infection than unvaccinated people. So if you take all the vaxxers and you put them here, you take all the unvaccinated and you put them here, and all the unvaccinated are hanging out together, they are much more likely to get infected than if they're hanging out with a lot of people who are vaccinated. So on just a practical data level, it doesn't make any sense at all. On a moral level, we are all adults, right? Everybody here is above the age, presumably, of 18. If you're above the age of 12 in the United States, then you've had the opportunity to get a vaccine. You're an adult. You get to live with the consequences of your own decision-making. You know, as we go down in terms of age striation, if you're 65 and you haven't had a vaccine, and there's no history of adverse reactions to vaccines, I think it's quite foolish for you not to get the vaccine. Because the risk of death for people who are above the age of 65 is pretty significant. If you are 17 or 18 years old, then obviously it's going to look more like a toss-up. I think that the stats still weigh in favor of vaccination, but it's a lot more narrow. And it also depends on the level of community infection, because the stats on community infection, likelihood of death or serious hospitalization goes up with your chances of actually getting infected. But as a general moral principle, if you choose not to get vaccinated and you're willing to bear the consequences of not being vaccinated, then I don't see what business it is of the government. And I'm losing my damned mind over this. I am. Because this started off with, we have to stop the hospitals from being overwhelmed. Fine, done. Then it went to, we have to wait until there's a vaccine. Fine, done. Then it was, we need to wait until every adult has had the opportunity to get the vaccine. Fine, done. As of today, 70% of all Americans above the age of 18 are vaccinated. 90% of all Americans above the age of 65 are vaccinated. So what the hell does the government have to say about any of this? Why is the government involved in any of this? We have now reached the end, except that I think that the left, in an unspoken assumption, has said we are after zero COVID, which was ridiculous and insane and merely an excuse for a forever pandemic. No scientist worth his salt believes, or has believed for the last year, that zero COVID was a possibility in a world where we have had literally hundreds of millions of infections at this point. No one believes that this wasn't going to become seasonal. No one believes that there aren't going to be variants. We all understand that risk. Also, it's called life, and there are risks every day, and we all have to assess those risks. And how we assess those risks is what makes us adults. And it's not the government's job to tell you how to assess that risk.
Howdy, Ben. Happy to have you in the Lone Star State. I'm Ryan. I just graduated from UT Austin. hook 'em horns in this past May. We just started to build a conservative community on our campus. It's actually moving much better than I ever could have imagined. But I'm starting to notice a division amongst the conservatives in our circle between the my way or the highway kind of people and the conservatives that are a little bit more flexible with policy. I feel like I'm also seeing that in Congress on like a higher level as well. How do you, or what are you seeing in the same way, and how worried are you about division in terms of like the 2022 election amongst conservatives?
So I'm always worried about division among conservatives. You know, I'm a big believer that, you know, urinate outside the tent, not in. I think that unfortunately there are a lot of conservatives who don't tend to feel the same way, and frankly they, you know, do really well attacking other conservatives for not being sufficiently adherent to whatever cause they're looking for inside the tent. What we should be learning from the left is that coalitions matter, right? The people who are the most effective on the left are not the AOCs of the crew, right? She's not particularly effective. The people who are most effective inside the Democratic Party are the people who have to glue the AOC wing together with the non-AOC wing of the party. And the same thing is always true inside the Republican Party as well. So when it comes to, you know, college campus politics, it seems to me the same thing. You have to form coalitions of people who agree on this particular issue. They may not agree on anything else, but it's really important to stick together and to not spend this time fighting with one another about policies that are not going to be productive. And again, it's really a matter of keep your eye on the prize. That doesn't mean sell out key conservative principles. It does mean that you're going to have to build coalitions toward any end that you seek. And recognizing that is the first step toward a successful politics. It's also why, I have it easy. I enjoy my job. I get to say what I want to every single day. When I spoke to all of the Republican Congress people a few weeks ago, I said, listen, my job is easy. I get to say what I want every single day. You have to lie to people every single day. That is the difference. And not only do you have to fib to people, you also have to build coalitions, and you have to write crappy legislation with 435 other people, and then you have to somehow ram through this legislation, this 3,000-page legislation that no one's ever... Like, that's a much harder job. So the trenches slog of it is a much harder job. And it does require a little bit of circumspection. But recognizing that is the first step toward success, I think.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Ben.
Hi, my name's Layton. I go to Lipscomb University in Nashville, Tennessee.
All right, Nashville. Yeah.
I'm from Los Angeles, so my question is, especially with the recall election upcoming, how do you make an impact in a city and, frankly, a state that just feels so far gone?
Yeah, you're asking the wrong person. I left. LA is a full-scale disaster area. I grew up there. I spent I'm 37 now. I spent 36 of my 37 years on Earth, with the exception of a couple years in law school, in LA. I was born in LA. I was married in LA. All three of my kids were born in LA. We left last year, and we could not be happier, because this country is fantastic outside of LA and New York. It really is. I mean, as far as those who are left behind, I mean, frankly, I think there's a very good shot that this ends with, you know, me with an eye patch like Snake Plissken trying to get you out as all of the various derelicts attempt to destroy you. But if you insist on staying and paying tax dollars to a horrific state entity, then I think that the blowback is beginning. Obviously, the recall election is going very poorly for Gavin Newsom. I thought a month ago it was impossible that he'd be recalled. Now I think there's actually kind of a 55-45 shot I still think it's likely he's not recalled, but I think it's much narrower. Like, the odds have really shifted, and I'm highly amused by the possibility of Larry Elder being governor of the state with like 13% of the vote. Like, I've been friends with Larry since I was like 16 years old, and that just, it's so great, because Larry does not give any Fs at all. And Larry's a libertarian, like a full-scale libertarian, like libertarian convention, like people dancing around with, like, naked at the libertarian, like that kind of Larry. Like, so Larry becomes governor, Larry's just gonna be like, I'm vetoing every single bill, no one's gonna, like, I hope. Because it'll be amusing to watch, I won't be there. I think that, listen, I'm a pessimist when it comes to California. I've watched it get worse every single year that I've been there for the past, like, 15. And so my recommendation is that California, which still has the most registered Republicans of any state in the union, every Republican in California should leave, and they should all go to Nevada, Arizona, Georgia, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Ohio, and every other swing state there is.
Good evening. My name is Piper Huddleston, and I'm attending a small private university in Memphis, Tennessee. It's called Rhodes College. That being said, my school at the end of June deemed that requiring every single student to get the vaccine was not constitutional, and it wasn't right until the vaccine gets an FDA approval. Then, 2 weeks after they told all the students that, they also told us that if we don't get vaccinated, we will be receiving a $1,500 fine per semester for not getting the vaccine. And I just wanted to know your opinion, hearing those facts.
Again, I mean, I think that that's crazy. I mean, I think that it's crazy to fine students for not getting the vaccine. Again, people who are least in danger from this vaccine are young, from the disease, are young, healthy people. The grand total of people under the age of 18 in the United States who have died from the vaccine, this says for CDC, I mean, from COVID. These are the CDC statistics as of today, because I looked them up this morning. 340 Americans under the age of 18 in a subgroup of 73 million Americans have died of COVID so far in the pandemic. Below the age of 30, that number rises between the ages of 18 and 29. That number is something like 2,400 Americans have died of COVID total across a pandemic that's killed 600,000 Americans. And so the sort of paranoid insanity of we're going to find everybody who doesn't have a vaccine on a college campus is pretty wild to me. It really is. And again, I thought the whole purpose of college was the assumption that everybody here is an adult. If it's not, then frankly, I have a lot of recommendations about what we should do with college. If we're going to go back to the notion that people in college are not capable of adulthood, there are a lot of recommendations that I have with what we should do with people in college, and many of them would be similar to how I treat my children. It might be good for them. But it's, but yes, I think that that sort of policy is foolish and counterproductive.
Hello, my name is Victoria, and I just graduated from the University of Virginia. I'm about to start my first year teaching in a public school. I never thought I would have to, you know, weigh my options on going to a private or public based on being, you know, in this situation with CRT and teachers being forced not to teach. So given that I don't want to give up on public school, what advice might you have for me? And second, where do you see this fight going, and how could the public schools return back to normalcy, arithmetic, reading, writing?
Yeah, I mean, things? So I think there are a few things here. One, just on a personal job level, moving to a right-to-work state is probably a good idea. With regard to public schools, public school teachers, you know, the AFT and the NEA are just disaster areas. They're some of the worst unions in America. They're just garbage. If you are insistent on remaining in Virginia and operating, you know, in the context of their public schools, the good news is that a lot of the local school boards are really pushing back and providing information to the local school boards and to the citizenry at large as to what's happening inside the classroom is really, really important. We get leaks at Daily Wire every day, and we're able to really push those pretty hard. I mean, it was a reporter from our website, actually, who was reporting first on sort of the uprising in Loudoun County that has turned into such a major issue.
I'm teaching in Loudoun County.
Yeah, exactly. So Loudoun County, there's real pushback, and that is absolutely wonderful. I also think that there's going to be a lot of support for if teachers end up being fired over this sort of stuff. I think there's going to be a lot of support for those teachers being able to teach in private schools with subsidies, too. I think that there's a lot of public support for teachers who are willing to do that sort of thing. But I think that the blowback on CRT is happening. I think it is quite real. The polling data shows that it is extremely unpopular. And I think that as long as parents stay active, and teachers are a big part of that, because, again, most parents have no transparency as to what's happening in the classroom. Teachers who convey that, whether it is through leaks or whether it is publicly, are doing the world a favor.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Cameron Spivey. I'm a history major at Washington and Lee University. And in response to the school's reassessment of Robert E. Lee's role as a legacy at the school, I compiled a historical pamphlet that was factually cited, giving data on what Lee did and why he is so famous for the school. And in response, there were students and faculty who bragged about ripping up the flyers before others saw them, and many labeled it as lost cause propaganda and wouldn't even look at the citations. So, and my question is just, how do you convince those moderates that don't really care about politics or these issues if you're not even able to present facts to them without it being skewed by the left?
So first of all, I think, frankly, the thing that's going to convince moderates is probably not the pamphlet. It's going to be the video of these jerks ripping up the pamphlet. Really, I think what tends to convince people in the middle is the behavior of people on the left more than the arguments of the right. And this is what we've been seeing repeatedly across the nation. When the left acts poorly, then people really react negatively to it. And so one video of people ripping down your poster and ripping it up is going to do more good with the administration and with people in the middle than the pamphlet itself probably would do. Now, that's not to rip on the pamphlet. I'm sure the pamphlet is really interesting and really good, and there's a lot to be said about Lee. There's a great essay by Christopher Caldwell recently in the Claremont Institute of Books, their book review, which is really worth reading. Claremont Review of Books is really interesting. And he had a really fabulous kind of shaded essay about who Lee was and what his legacy is in the United States that's worthy of consideration. But again, the good news is the worse the left acts, the better it is for us. And there's no shortage of them acting like complete jerks.
Hey, Ben, it's good to see you. I have a short proposal for you and then a question, but we have a conservative musician group chat. We all study music. Oh, my name's Jonathan, by the way. I study music at UBC. And we all agree that you need a better theme song for your show.
Okay.
So you want to commission us to play it for you?
Okay, so a couple of things about this. First of all, you are 180% correct. It is so true. Okay. Okay. This is the pro. When you launch a company, you'll see this, okay? When you bootstrap yourself into existence, there are certain things that just get carried along as like evolutionary holdovers, and the guitar riff at the beginning is that thing, right? So what happened, like, here's the backstory on the guitar riff at the beginning of my show. So the show is starting. We're literally doing it from Jeremy Boring's pool house. It was really like me in a pool house with like a couple of guys who we were friends with and no room, and it's wild. If you go back and watch the first episode and you see how far we've come, it's pretty cool. And we didn't even have music the first episode. About 3 weeks in, they hand-build that set. Anybody remember the old set that had, like, the boards in the back, like, the wooden boards in the back? Right, that was, like, a couple of guys who we knew who literally just went in one day and just nailed together a bunch of boards, and that was the backdrop of my show. And we realized that we needed some marker for the audio editors to cut around, right? They needed some sort of cue for the graphic to fly in. The problem was that licensing music is super expensive. And we were deeply afraid that if we were to use unlicensed music, then it would get pulled down or people on the left would, you know, own the music and go crazy. And by the way, talk radio has been living in this kind of gray space for a while. Every time you listen to talk radio and you hear a song that you know that comes in from the bumper, they're basically living in a very gray space in American law, and there's a very good shot that at some point somebody's going to sue for residuals and it's going to get super ugly. So we decided we weren't going to do that. Instead, we got Jeremy Boring's brother, Will, to literally go in a studio and play a guitar for 35 seconds, okay? And that became that riff. Then they've proposed to me several alternatives, none of them very good, and the problem is it's become Pavlovian for a lot of people. Right now, they hear the riff and they know that it's the show, so it's actually this terrible guitar riff has become part of the show almost permanently. So, in other words, for us to shift that, you'd have to blow my socks off, but I'm totally open for it. Like.
Do we have time for the other question?
What was the other question? The first one is good, so I'll give you time.
All right, thank you. So I have a lot of family that's, you know, undocumented immigrants. And so I see firsthand, you know, how good, you know, these types of people can do for the country. And as we, like, in the present, 90% of the people who are deported are, you know, because they committed a crime or something like that. So technically, we kind of already have some sort of amnesty, if you will. So I just wanted to ask what your position is on amnesty for, you know, law-abiding citizens that have been here, you know, 20-plus years or something like that.
So my position on amnesty is the same as my position on immigration, which is that if we have the resources to analyze several hundred million, IRS returns every year, then we have the resources to analyze it on an individual level whether people should stay or whether they should go. And we do this on immigration all the time, right? If you're a new immigrant, then you have to go through a process, and we have to determine whether we think you're going to be good for the country or bad for the country. There are a lot of undocumented immigrants who have been living here for a really long time, illegal immigrants, and they did immigrate illegally, but that doesn't mean the end of the world, right? I mean, that's a lot of people overstay their visas, a lot of people came through the southern border, have been very productive citizens, and would be excellent additions to the country as citizens. And there are a lot of people who have not. It's up to the country to decide, essentially, whether they should stay or whether they should go. I don't think that presence in the country alone is enough to demarcate whether somebody should stay or go, and I don't think duration of presence in the country is enough to demarcate whether somebody should stay or they should go. So criminality, I don't think, is the only standard. I think it is a very strong standard. If you commit a crime, you certainly should go. But let's say that you've been in the United States for a long time, you've been receiving, you know, soft forms of welfare because some forms of welfare are banned, some kind of through back doors or not. But let's say that you've been sort of a net drain on the resources of the state or locality. If you've been here 30 years, I don't really care. I don't think the United States should continue to subsidize you. If you've been here working a job and you've raised a family, you should go to the back of the line and then we should analyze you. And if you deserve to be here and if you're going to be a net addition to the United States, then we should make you a citizen. We should give you a pathway. But it needs to be done on an individual level. And I'm always puzzled when people do this on the basis of sort of like an entire class of people, as though the country doesn't have a stake in determining who comes in the country. Right, we shouldn't be doing this as like entire group of people from this age to this age who came in this year from this country should get to stay. I don't understand why it would work that way. We should be analyzing as, again, I believe in seeing people as individuals. This is true of illegal immigrants as well. People who came here illegally, if you are a benefit to the country, you went to a lot of so-called dreamers, right? People who came in as children, they went to college, they're now graduating from UCLA with a degree in engineering. Is it a good idea for us to deport them? I don't think so. If somebody, you know, came as a child, you know, hasn't been arrested for a crime, but dropped out of high school and is now a member of a gang, should we deport them? Of course. It should be done on an individual level as opposed to doing it just sort of as a broad class. And I think most Americans can get on board with this. Most Americans basically say, shut the border, figure out what to do with the people here, right? And it should be two separate things. It shouldn't be all in one. Because you need to first shut the border so you're not incentivizing people to cross illegally more, and then you need to figure out what to do with the people here. But both parts are required.
Thank you.
Hi, Ben. My name is Jan Soto. I am from the University of Central Florida. We're happy to have you this September.
I appreciate it. Thank you. Florida, yeah, my new home state.
Yeah, there you go.
Florida's fantastic.
There you go. So I wanted to ask you, I am the only student from the University of Central Florida, 70,000 numbered studentry school. And many times when I talk with fellow conservatives, I feel like it's almost like an underground network.
Yes.
We're all secretly conservative, and when we go and reveal it to each other, we have a joke. It's like almost going out of the closet as conservative. My point is, I am here because I want to learn the skills to empower myself on this campus and to be able to share conservative values. But how do I encourage people who are conservative and who are afraid and who just simply choose to stay in the shadow?
So I think that you have to divide conservatives between... It's a rolling just like gender is a spectrum. In enthusiasm for being involved in politics is a spectrum. You have to start with people who are the most committed and the most interested in the fight, and then you have to gradually expand the concentric circles until you get to the people who are the least interested. And it's good to have them in your Rolodex, but there are a lot of people who are just, like, you have to understand what people's commitments are going to be. And again, I think this is true in most areas of life. You have to meet people where they are. And so trying to convince somebody who's really hesitant and really nervous that today is the day they need to stand up is very difficult. But if you got a crowd of 500 people and they are 501, they might be more likely to show up. And so you sort of have to, even in your own mind and in your own mental Rolodex, determine who's the most, who are the people I can count on? Who are the people who are, I mean, let's be real. We all do this with our friends, right? They're the people who are going to drive you to the airport, right? Those are your close friends. And then they're the people who are going to stop over if you have free food. And those are your not as close friends. And then they're the people who are just going to borrow money from you who aren't your friends at all. Those are your relatives. So, yeah, it's the same thing when it comes to activism. You have to decide who's most enthusiastic, start with those people, build a core out from there. As the numbers increase, you're more likely to get people who are willing to hang out with you because, again, people want to come to a party. They don't want to be the only person at the party.
Thank you.
Thanks so much. All righty, I really appreciate it. Thank you so much. It's great to be live with you again, and have a wonderful event.